Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my Lord and you are together lovely and all together worthy and all together wonderful to me. Light of the world, sing the light.
Often said that oftentimes we see a rose bush and we see the roses blooming and blossoming, and often we want the roses, but seldom do we want the thorns. And I submit to you, dear friends, that the thorns that are sent our way, the thorns that we have to deal with in our lives, are those thorns that actually bring about tremendous blessings in our life. Our Apostle Paul, who knows all too well about the thorn, the Apostle Paul who wrote a third of the New Testament, the Apostle Paul who was well versed in some 13 languages, this Apostle Paul who became an ambassador for Jesus Christ, who met the Lord himself on the road to Damascus, this Apostle Paul who has converted the Gentiles everywhere preaching the word, this Apostle Paul has been stricken with a thorn. But let's see why, dear friends. Let's look at why the apostle will receive such a thorn. You know the story. Paul has been throughout this Corinthian letter, 2 Corinthians in particular, Paul has been defending his apostleship, defending his motives, defending who he is as a God sent. He is now giving them a bird's eye view of what God allowed him to experience. And if you know anything about the Greeks during that time, they boasted in glory of self. They boasted in wealth. They boasted in knowledge. And so they often would parade themselves around for people to see their wealth, for people to know how knowledgeable they were. They lauded into such an attitude, this attitude of egotism and arrogance was one that was prevalent during this time. But Paul flips the coin by showing them that he, if anyone had reason to boast, it would be him. And if it was anyone who could pat his chest and give himself praise, Paul would say it would be me. And here's why. Because it was God who allowed me up into the third heavens. It was God who allowed me to see some things that are now forbidden to speak about. It was God who allowed me the privilege that I have of being able to go to a place no man has gone. And Paul says, and as a result, I came down and it was forbidden. I was censored by heaven itself from speaking about the things that I heard and saw. But then Paul says, but here is the reason. He says, as I come down from this third heaven, as I am trying to digest and to take in all of what I saw and I heard, Paul says, there was given me a thorn in the flesh. Now, I want you to notice the source of Paul's pain, purpose of Paul's pain, and the promise in the pain that Paul experienced. Now, the source of Paul's pain was pointed and physical. It was a thorn. He uses a metaphorical language to describe the pain that was plaguing him. And he says, this thorn could be a stake or a spike, but it was something that caused pain. It was something that caused trouble and difficulty, suffering and inconvenience in the life of Paul. This thorn, church, was in the present tense, which means this thorn continuously plagued Paul. It continuously gave him pain. It continuously burdened him. And church, we are no different from Paul. We live in this world as children of God, as strangers in a world that is slowly deteriorating. We're living in a world where people are disregarding God and the Lord Jesus Christ, persecution of Christians, mockery made of those because of their faith, becomes in some sense a thorn. But Paul says here, This thorn has plagued me. This thorn has been so painful that it would not go away. And I just believe, church, that some of us listening today, we have a thorn in one shape or another that's plaguing us, that's causing difficulty to us, that is bringing intense pain in our life and suffering in our life, that we are just asking God to simply take it away. This thorn, though, that Paul would announce that he had, he says it was given to him. Look at verse number 7. Because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, for this reason it was given. Watch this. To keep me from exalting myself. And there was given me a thorn in the flesh. It was a messenger of Satan to buffet me, to torment me. So now Paul says this thorn was allowed by God. It was given to me. It was allowed by God, and it was used by the devil. He says, and this thorn used by the devil, when he uses the term buffer, it means to beat with a closed fist. So Paul says, in order to keep me where God wanted me, he allowed this thorn in my life, and whatever this thorn was, whatever this pain was that plagued Paul, Satan used it. He used it to buffet Paul. He used it to beat Paul. He used it to discourage Paul. He even used it to try to stop Paul's ministry. And church, Satan is still adamant about using whatever thorn is in your life to cause you discomfort, to cause you to discredit God, to cause you to give up on God. He constantly beats you. He constantly nags at you. He constantly plagues you with pain that simply won't go away. And sometimes, church, we lose sight of what God is doing in our life because we know God has all power, but it is at this point in our life with the pain that we feel, God will not take it away. The devil uses pain to inflict us continuously. And here it is, church. To become a Christian is not to escape suffering, but to be able to endure pain by the grace of God with dignity and hope. Here it is, church. We are not we have not become children of God to escape pain, to escape suffering. We have become children of God so that by the grace of God, we can live through the pain, endure the pain with dignity and hope, because we know that the pain brings about greater glory in the sight of God. The source of pain is his thorn. The source and his is the culprit of the pain is the devil. Can you really serve the Lord? Are you willing to trust the Lord in your pain, even though he says he will not take it away? Here's the purpose of the pain. He says it was given to me to keep me from exalting myself. Now look at that. The purpose of the pain, church, was to remind Paul of his humanity. It was to humble Paul and to remind him of his humanity. Think about it, church. Whenever we have experienced success in our life, oftentimes when we have been elevated and we have been graduated to a new position, to a new stage or status in life, oftentimes, church, we become high-minded. We become arrogant. And there are some Christians like that. They've overcome some sense of they've gotten victory over some vice in their life. They've overcome drug addiction. They've overcome smoking or drinking. They've overcome promiscuity. But then what happens to them, they become high-minded. And they believe that everybody that doesn't live the way they live, everybody who isn't as strong as they are, everybody who doesn't quote as many scriptures as they quote, they look down upon people like that, and they become no earthly good to God while on earth to help anyone else. You have to be careful at when God elevates you. You have to be careful, dear friends, when you have been blessed by God and you have been elevated by God, that you do not become bigger than God in your own sight. And so what happens? God recognizes that. He knows us better than we know ourselves, and he gives us, he allows the thorn in our life to bring us back down to humanity. He wants us to recognize that we are human flesh, that we are the creation and not the creator. Paul says the purpose of the pain was to remind me of my humility. It was to keep me from lifting myself out of my own place. In other words, Paul says, God had to make sure that is, that I did not get too big for my spiritual riches. He says that God had to humble me and keep me humble so that I would not become bigger than the God who gave me the revelation. So now, the other thing we see within the purpose of this pain is that it reminds us that this is about God and not us. Yeah, this is about God. So what that means, pain leads us to a denial of self-sufficiency. See, what happens, pain, when pain sets in, and when that pain won't go away, that pain reminds us of our human flesh. It reminds us that it is not about God. And the longer the pain persists, the more we relinquish self-sufficiency and we depend on God. We then recognize that it is about God, it's only about God, and it has ever since been about God. And so we realize that through pain. God allows it so that it can keep us with a sober mind, a clear mind, and on purpose with God's will. So thirdly, it reminds us that pain is developmental, and it causes us to depend on our God. See, so pain doesn't destroy us. The pain God uses is simply developmental. It is simply to strengthen us and to bring us to a point of maturity with God. See, oftentimes we are quick to say we have faith in God. We are quick to say we're going to stay with God. We're quick to say we love God until the pain hits. And when the pain sets in, that's when we really see the real Christian from counterfeit Christian. So Paul says it reminds me of my humanity. It reminds me that this is about God. And it reminds me, church, that my pain is developmental. But then, pain, the purpose of pain, draws us closer to God. Now notice, he says, concerning this, I implored the Lord three times that it might leave me. So now notice, this pain is designed, church, to draw us closer to God. Satan uses the pain to try to draw us further from God. But this pain, God allows and God uses for his glory and honor, always has a purpose of greater good for the children of God. And so Paul is showing us that this pain that I experience drew me closer to God and not further away from God. Notice, he says in verse 8, I implored the Lord three times that it might leave me. Paul says this pain was so unbearable, I prayed fervently to God that it may be taken away. Notice 2 Corinthians chapter 4. See, it draws us, and that's how you have to see this, church, that pain, the pain draws us to deeper fellowship and intimacy with God, draws us to deeper connection with God. Now notice chapter 4, verse number 8. Paul says, we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not despairing, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So he says, the purpose of my pain, the purpose of the suffering that I go through, he says, it's the dying of self, and it's the connection that I have with Jesus. So the more I die to self, the more Jesus is revealed and manifested in my life. It brings me in a closer concert and connection with my Lord and Savior. And Paul says one of the most pertinent ways that we get closer to God is in the midst of pain. Notice 2 Corinthians chapter 4. It equips us to help others. Did you know that God allows pain for the express purpose of equipping us to help other people? Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. Therefore, we do not lose hope or lose heart. Though our outer man is decayed, our inner man is being renewed day by day. For this momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond consolation. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Look at chapter 5. Verse 14 says, for the love of Christ controls us, having concluded this, that one died for all, therefore all died. And he died for all, so that they who live might no longer live to themselves. Watch this. But for him who died and rose again on their behalf. So now Paul says it equips us to help others. It equips us, it controls us, it constrains us, that the only thing we are compelled to do is to live for Jesus and to help others in need. And it comes through our pain. God uses the pain to control it, or to actually compel us into service. But now back up to verse chapter 4. Don't miss verse 16 and 17. When Paul talks about not losing heart, and though our outer man is decaying, our inner man is being renewed, the third thing that it does is it prepares us for heaven. So pain, church, draws us to God. Pain equips us to help others, and pain prepares the child of God for heaven. So Paul says, the response that I got was one that perhaps I was not expecting. Now notice the promise of the grace in the pain. He says, concerning this, I implored the Lord 3 times that it might leave me. He said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather boast about my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am well content with weaknesses, with insults, with distresses, and with persecutions, and with difficulties for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. So now, the promise of grace in the pain is a promise. Write this down. It's a promise of divine grace. It's a promise that God gives to the child of God that empowers him or her to live for God in the heart, heat, and midst of pain. He says, he said to me, so now notice, those of you who have the Bible written and read, the words of Jesus written and read, you will quickly notice, church, that the response didn't come from God. The response should be written and read. And it came from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He says, I implored the Lord 3 times. I asked the Lord 3 times to deliver me from this pain. Now notice, The fact that he asked three times should have let him know that God had already given him the answer. That God was not going to remove the thorn. The pain would be there. But what God was going to do through Jesus Christ was give him enough grace, more than enough grace, to endure the pain. Notice, he says, and he said, that's in red, Jesus himself, who usually intercedes for us, he steps in and he speaks to his child. I think it's a song we often sing, just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. And that's true, because Paul would say, when I ask the Lord to remove this thorn from me, when I ask the Lord to remove this pain, it was Jesus who responded. And is sufficient. So Paul receives the promise of divine grace and the promise of divine sufficiency. In other words, everything that the Lord will give him was sufficient enough to take care of Paul's need. As a matter of fact, Jesus was himself sufficient enough to take care of what Paul was going through. To empower Paul to continue to preach the gospel, to save souls, to show forth the power of Christ in his life. Jesus was all sufficient in the life of Paul. His grace was more than sufficient for the life of Paul. And Jesus is reminding us today that his grace is what's going to get you through. His grace is what's going to get you to heaven. It is Jesus who is sufficient. There is nothing else that can take the place of Jesus that will be sufficient enough to take care of your pain. And then you have the promise of divine sovereignty. Yeah. So here it is, church. Paul says, I'd rather boast. See, usually the Greeks would boast in wealth, they would boast in knowledge, they would boast in self, they would boast in all types of things. But Paul flips the coin and he says, no, the reason I boast, he says, I'm boasting in my weakness. I refuse to puff myself up because I know that it's Jesus and only Jesus who lives and reigns in me and who accomplishes much in this old feeble body of mine. He says, I'd rather boast about my weaknesses. Watch this. So that the power of Christ may dwell, may abide, may rule, may live in me. Here it is. Real power is not always in deliverance, but the God-given ability to deal with our pain. See, often we think the power was in God delivering us, when the power was in God getting us through the pain. He kept us and aided us to get through it, right? Yeah, so the deliverance isn't always in, a power isn't always in the deliverance, but it is in the God-given ability to deal with pain. Paul, here it is, church, was asking God for what he needed, and God simply reminded him of what he already had. You've got to understand, church, when the pain comes, when you're being nagged and you're being beaten by the devil with whatever your thorn is, oftentimes we ask God for deliverance. We ask God for what we need or what we think we need. We ask God, and God has to simply remind us, the reason I'm saying no to you is because you're asking me for something you already have. Yeah, he had grace. He had abundant grace. He had the power of God, the presence of God. He had all the love of God already working in his life. And so what he was asking for, God had to remind him of what he already had by even denying his request. Watch this. Lastly, church, the thing that causes you pain is the thing that brings about power. Yeah, the thing, see, we think that's why we often want the pain to be removed, because the thing that brings up, but we've got to remember what brings pain, the very thing that brings pain, God uses it to bring about and manifest power in our life. I know that to be true because Jesus took pain and turned it into power. It was Jesus who received the crown of thorns, pain. It was Jesus who was beaten, black and blue, pain. It was Jesus who received whip after whip, having his body back lacerated and open, pain. It was Jesus who carried his own cross up Golgotha's hill, pain. It was Jesus who opened his hands willingly so that they would drive the stakes through his hands, pain. The same would be for his feet. He endured pain. Here he is being raised up on the hill, struggling to breathe, struggling to take in air and oxygen, pain. And then the ultimate pain was having his father, for that brief moment, step away from his son, because his son bore the sins of our wrongdoing. Pain. Yet he turned the pain into power, because he got up 3 days later and he declared, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." Now you go and preach that power. It's the gospel power that changes the sinner. It's the gospel power that changes man's mind. It's the gospel power that cleans up our speech. It's the gospel power that will eradicate racial tensions in this world. It's the gospel power that will help man see the sinfulness and the fallenness of humanity. It's only through the gospel power. God took pain and turned it into power. Well, I want to leave you with just these four things. The fruits of our pain and suffering is that it's profitable. It is profitable for you to endure pain. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. Secondly, pain and suffering develops trust in God. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. Pain and suffering develop character in the child of God. James chapter 1, verse 3. And pain and suffering deepens fellowship with God. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 26, and 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7. My dear friends, let us continue to trust in the grace of God. Let us continue to stand on the promise of God's grace. And may we forever be humble in the sight of God. May we recognize that the pain, the thorn, is given to us for express purpose, and that we will always receive grace, what we need to endure the pain. If you are not a child of God, I would suggest that you become one, because when pain hits, you're going to need someone to turn to. When life becomes so tough that you don't have a way out, you're going to need Jesus in your life. Give your life to the Lord. Believe, put faith in the Lord Jesus. Repent of your sins and be immersed into Christ for the forgiveness of your sins.